welcome you all, and especially our speaker of the day, my not only friend and colleague for the last, I think, more than four decades. I call him Satyan, of course, and Dr. Allapathy Satyanarayana has been an eminent plant breeder of international repute. Has born in a small village, Gudavalli in Guntur district, where he is even settled now after retirement. He obtained his bachelor's, master's and doctorate degrees from the Banaras Hindu University with outstanding merit. Starting as a lecturer in same place, Banaras Hindu University, and then he, through the ARS stream, where he was the first ranker in plant breeding, and he pushed me to the third rank. We both went into the exam together and studied together, and he joined ICF, and we were together there for several years before he moved on to Angrao as associate professor in 1981. He had a very fruitful and illustrious career as a pulse breeder, and developed a number of vegetable and pulse varieties through his career that have revolutionized production in various niches of pulses before he retired from Angrao as director of extension. During his illustrious career, he had many key positions in the university, and even after his retirement, he is still very active in developing high yielding disease resistant varieties, hybrids of field crops as well as vegetable crops, in addition to educating farmers on sustainable agricultural practices. That's a real good social work he is doing. And the impact of his few things, you know, it's, if I keep on talking about his contributions, it might take the whole 40 minutes. So I'll just be brief that his pulses, especially 40 high yielding pulse varieties, 13 black gram, 9 green gram, 11 red gram and 5 Bengal gram and 2 horse gram were introduced by him. And later on, he also added virus resistance because that was one of the shortcomings. 4,000 crore worth of additional income to the farmers by today's standards is what his research impact has been. And he was honored with National Awards, Hooker Award in 1999 and ISPRD Award in 1994. And also a silent revolution of chickpea in AP with his entiring efforts in collaboration with ICRISAD. And we are fortunate that we have Dr. Jagdish Kumar, who was also a well-known chickpea breeder. He's also in the audience. He's sitting very close to Dr. Satyanarayana today. And he, along with him, developed some chickpea areas, and the chickpea area increased fivefold during 1998 to 2008 with those releases and his work on that. Dr. Satyanarayana was invited by the ICRISAD to deliver Institute of seminar on silent revolution of chickpea in 2013. For outstanding contributions, he received two international awards, King Bao Doin Award and by ICRISAD, and Duren Margaret Marshaller Distinguished Achievement Award in 2002. And he has also served in many research advisory committees for both government of AP and as well as ICR. Some of them he was also chairing them. He has Dolichos and French bean. I think one of them, when he was in IHR, he developed a variety called Arka Komal, and it became the benchmark. I think 84% of the breeder seed and, you know, of beans in India was Arka Komal. So cutting this story short, I mean, he has been a, you know, innovative pulse breeder. He has been a teacher, and he has also had a lot of social work that he continues to do today. And he's also been involved in the SRI, the system of rice intensification, for which also he was awarded a lot of administrative experience. And I think I can go on and go on. So thank you for accepting this invitation to speak today on pulses, which is your favorite crop. We look forward to hearing your, you know, achievements in the crop, and I'm sure a lot of people will learn from that about the breeding of pulses. Over to you, Satyan.
Happy to see many of my old friends' faces here. Dr. Tikku, number one, Dr. Angadi, Dr. Karakwal, and Dr. Vanjari. I think all these people with whom I worked. And I I welcome all of you for my talk. If someone doesn't want to call it as pulse crops, you can call it as grain legumes.
Okay.
It is as good as that. So I am not a frontline breeder, or we can say the frontier breeder. I am only a conventional plant breeder all through my life, and it has resulted good varieties. And now, for example, now we are all trying with the system, unable to fix eco. So this is what happens when you go with a frontline technologies. So the topic is genetic upgradation of grain legumes yield potential. Why I choose this topic is not only that I worked with this crop, but these are a group of crops neglected. They are relegated and ultimately say they are low yielders. Why they are low yielders, what made them low yielders is the one I will just discuss, and also put few points how to make them better plants. You just see, it is a pigeon pea plant. Can you imagine a pigeon pea yielding like this? You may think that somebody has tied up the branches like that, but it is a single plant. And if that is so, then it can compete with soybean, it can compete with even cereals like wheat. 2016 was declared as the international year of pulses. Why? To help overcome protein hunger, because that is the most important problem in the world. There are three dimensions of hunger: caloric hunger, protein malnutrition, hidden hunger, micronutrient deficiency. All the three occurs in India. But whenever we talk about a nutritional food, pulses come to our mind first, because only pulses will have the carbohydrates, protein and micronutrients. None other grains will have so much. If you talk about millet, they are rich in micronutrients. If you talk about rice and wheat, they are more in calories. But protein coupled with calories and also with micronutrients, grain legumes is the only answer. In India, we produce about 170 lakh tons of legumes and import 54 lakh tons. The demand is, to meet the minimum requirement, is 240 lakh tons. There is still a deficit of 16 lakh tons. That's why most people doesn't get pulses sufficient for their dietary intake. Now, this is an average. And you can see in a rich man or an average middle man, they eat more pulses and then make pulses unavailable to poor people. Why pulses are low yields? This is what a statement everybody makes throughout the world, is pulses are energy-rich crops grown under energy starvation. Means without much inputs on a relegated soils. Even when the irrigation developed with the Green Revolution, cereal crops took the areas where pulses used to be grown earlier, and they were further relegated to marginal lands. So this was the statement given. Whether statement is correct or not, now my colleagues and learned people will tell me at the end of the day. They also spend a lot of energy on biological nitrogen fixation, which is extra. Now, to convert just into starch, plant needs 1.2 gram glucose to 1 gram starch. Similarly, for fat, 1.8 gram, for protein, 2.2 gram. That means a crop rich in protein requires more equivalent glucose. So now, with this background, since they are energy rich crops, they are grown under poor soils, their yields are low. This is a statement finally made. But what about soybean? Soybean is a crop, is almost like a legume, other grain legumes, with 42% and 20% oil, yields up to 4.5 to 5 tons are realized with these crops. Why? And how? Why not in legumes like green gram, black gram, red gram, chickpea, etc.? All because soybean is a plant type. It has a plant type which bears more pods. See, yield means more number of pods. A plant bearing more number of pods, how it can bear more number of pods, that has to be explained, and then reconstruct the plant type so that it use more pods per plant. Pulses are also called unique jewels of Indian crop husbandry because they are good for us, they are good for the soil health, they are good for animal health, animal feed, and they are climate smart. So keeping these things, if you keep in mind, the Indian soils remained fertile for over millennia of years only because Indian farmer judiciously mixed these grain legumes into the cropping systems, which is now missing. Neglecting pulses towards cereals in the irrigated area like rice wheat cropping system or rice cropping systems or commercial crops like cotton and all has resulted in a compromise for human health and sustainable food production. We are facing these two problems now. Human health problems have multiplied. Everybody is spending more money on their health. Now, when the problem of low productivity of pulses have been discussed at length in various forms, right from the last 50, 60 years, and a number of measures to overcome were suggested, but the production remained stagnant. Where did the planning go wrong? This is a question mark we have to put for everybody. Everybody says varietal requirement for each niche need to be identified, a normal routine thing. Priority must be given for location-specific research, yes, given. Introduced pulses in various cropping systems, yes, introduced. Thereby, they share the advantage of fertile land and better management, yes, but the pulses production remained stagnant. That means there is some point we are still missing where things are going wrong, where we are not able to give out our hand. Now, if you take an example of rice-based cropping systems, pulses in rice-based cropping systems, pre-rice, pulse and rice, followed by pulse. This is actually in most of the areas. Usually, rice and pulse, rice in kharif, pulse in rabi is the major cropping system. Rice pulse in late winter, because where the kharif rice is sown late or long duration rices are grown. Then the third one is rice pulse, summer pulse is also there. That means when you talk of simple rice-based cropping system, you have so many systems in the country, in the different states, and the soil, climate, and season are different, hence varietal need is also different. We say these are something like we recommend for rice fallows. The system doesn't work. So high-yielding varieties developed elsewhere. For example, if someone developed good varieties in Madhya Pradesh or in Maharashtra or so, if they are introduced in rice fallows of Andhra Pradesh, they fail to give satisfactory yields. That means the location-specific needs are important and that has to be worked out. And the local varieties have to be improved rather than introducing new variety from other places. And that was my example, my experience. When I started my work on rice fallow pulses in 1982, I faced the same thing. 460 germplasm lines were put and none was superior to any of the local variety. And the local varieties were also poor yielders. They have so many biotic stresses undergoing. So I took the local varieties to improve. And the first variety, LB17, powdery mildew resistant variety, when it got to the farmers' fields, the average yields from 2 quintal per acre has gone to 8 quintal per acre. A big jump that shows identifying the correct point and then attacking at it will result in good yields. So in rice fallows, what you see is we broadcast the seed. So plant stand establishment is poor. Weed menace, because the soil is not tilled. Plant grows on only the residual moisture and fertility. And slow growth during early stages because of excessive soil moisture at the time of sowing. Terminal moisture stress because no water is given. Cooler temperatures at the time of sowing. Then soil-borne diseases, salinity, and finally at present yellow mosaic virus are the various constraints in pulse production. But these are all abiotic and biotic constraints. Then factors that influence pulse yields in rice-based cropping system also. Time of sowing is critical, second fortnight of November. But this depends on the duration of the rice variety sown in the kharif season. But variety per se has no influence, that was my conclusion. But time of sowing, for which what we do? Select rice varieties in such a way that they come to harvest by during second fortnight of November. Sowing pulses by broadcasting standing crop requires higher seed rate, and skill is required to achieve the optimum plants, and these skills have been taught to our farmers here. Now they are able to establish in 18 to 20 kg per acre. Scope for fertilizer application is poor, almost nil, negligible, because we sow the seed in the standing paddy crop. Hence, management with foliar nutrition needs to be standardized. Application of potassium humic acid was found to be better for uptake of residual fertility, but nutrients, and also for increasing yields. These are the things I am not explaining, because this I am explaining the system now. Mehlbauer 1998 quoted that the success of black gram and rice fallows of AP is an emerging trend in legumes. So they recognized the work of the genotype for rice fallows. And then introduction of grain legumes in rice-based cropping systems increased the productivity and sustainability of the system. Dr. Paroda and Dr. Swaminathan, independently, they have come out with this. And both of them have visited my place in Guntur. Then what is required for higher yield? We are all talking of higher yield. Whether we talk, my talk, Tikku talks, or Vanjari talks, we talk all our varieties are high yielders. But most of our breeding programs are not aimed at breeding for higher yields, but they are aimed at defect elimination. That means a disease resistance, a pest resistant, abiotic resistance, or something like that. Something now, every time now we think of molecular breeding to introduce a gene only to eliminate a defect. Improvement of yield potential per se is the toughest and rarely achieved. This is what I underline. How you go for yield potential increase. Breakthrough in yield barriers will be most rewarding. And this is the one which I recommend for any crop, not only the grain legume. Conceptualize morphological framework to achieve higher yield. That means I am indicating that we should make an idiotype. Convergence breeding based on idiotype concept needs attention. So combination of morphological and physiological traits that contribute to yield and converge them into an idiotype and breed component by component will result in this. I am stressing that because the legumes are self-pollinated crops. For that matter, except maize, none of the crops we handle doesn't show inbreeding depression. When there is no inbreeding depression, we don't have to think of a hybrid. But hybrids is the era. This is the era of hybrids. Unless hybrid is there, there is no business. And then now the plant breeding is art and science and business of crop improvement. So business is important. Hybrids are important. But you can produce a variety as good as a hybrid. I give an example here. Dr. Tikku knows there is a variety called in watermelon, Arkamonic. Arkamonic is derived from the hybrid Arca, I don't remember that the first hybrid released in IIHR, and that was the time I joined. Then I challenged that, and cucurbits have no inbreeding depression, but by following the pedigree, we can get a better variety. So they got a Arkamonic much better than the original hybrid. Now, in case of plant type improvement increases productivity. I said main stem bearing, sympodial bearing in black gram, branch terminal cluster habit of green gram, long fruiting primary branches of ENP, a canopy change structure to suit mechanical harvesting, are the few things coupled with early vigor. All pulses have low initial vigor, but we need to have in high initial vigor. Plant types to achieve higher yield in black gram are main stem bearing. That means it will have axillary pods in addition to normal cluster at each node. So that together, it gives 7 to 8 pods per node against 3 to 4 pods in the normal one. This is a main stem bearing habit, and I released a variety called Maruti on that. Now, when you talk about sympodial bearing, I don't have a photo here. I have photo separately. This gives a cluster habit, like just like cluster bean. So indeterminate pod bearing in cluster bean. They have very short internodes, short peduncles, and 8 to 12 pods per cluster. And this sympodial bearing, when combined with mainstem bearing, it resulted in a soybean type of bearing. And then that means we are climbing to close to a soybean, which makes made soybean very high yielding among the grain legumes. Physiological studies revealed zinc is limiting in black gram. That's not the source. That means we have to increase the zinc. Hence, utilizing the new plant types in breeding, the productivity will be enhanced. And the productivity can be enhanced by 40 to 50%. And this you please note down, 40 to 50% enhancement can come, whereas Dinkum 1994 predicted possibility of raising ceiling of genetic yield only up to 25% through modification of the morphological traits of currently available high yielding varieties. That means he also did not foresee that there can be an alternate plant type which will help in doubling that yield potential. Genetic improvement of untapped physiological parameters. These are the things we never use in commonly in our plant breeding, but we only read. Enhancement of radiation use efficiency. I think not many people have put that into use. Photosynthetic translocation efficiency. Unloading leaf sucrose into phloem to maximize source equilibrium. Maybe finally converting C3 to C4, which people are working at International Rice Research Institute. I don't know how far they are successful. Understanding the genetic nature of physiological traits. So finally, screening methodology to incorporate these traits. These are the things which we need to think of and then incorporate into our plant types and so further yield levels. Now, when we come to Fusion P, this is our most important pulse. When you talk about Dal, Dal means Fusion P. It offers an opportunity for faster productivity enhancement with intensive research. Fusion P has the capacity to cope up with climate change. It is an underexploited crop. Fusion P genome is sequenced. Even in tomatoes, you can have a variety as good as, better than the hybrid also, provided you have the patience to build the plant type. So this is what the concept.
I don't agree there, but I don't want to start that debate. I don't agree. But
okay,
that is separate. That is separate debate.
Okay. Okay. Let me go through.
Yeah. Then we'll have at the end. At the end we'll have debate.
Yeah. So this type of breeding, the long primary branches into, for example, if the same long primary branches are in a hybrid, it is a plant type.
Yes.
It is not moving now.
Yeah.
Stop sharing. Say no. This fellow. This is not moving, the slide. Slide more.
Such an interesting topic, and we are getting this.
See, further,
everybody can say,
plant type, I got a plant with so many primary branches, no secondary branches, and this was released as Arjun.
Yeah.
And this Samir was a Chris at Pigeon Pea Breeder at that time. He visited, and you see the branching, primary branches only, and fully loaded. Excellent. So this is, I am to say, you have to come up with a plant type.
I agree, yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. This is the trait I used for PGNP plant type. This is the variety Raja I released. This is the variety Arjun I released. And then same Arjun. Now, super early red grams are also needed. to fit into different seasons because they are photo and dharma insensitive. And then not much attention is made on this group because they are having very high harvest index also. But question is, their plant types are small. You have to increase biomass coupled with harvest index. We have varieties Ishwari in 90 to 100 days. See, this is the Ishwari variety where we have planted only at 18 centimeter row to row. Now coming to some basic plant breeding to help that concept which I have given, you know, putting inherited superiority to work is a major objective in a plant breeding. The last sentence, breeding is an art, science and business of crop improvement. This business of crop improvement has made hybrids into business, and that's how we are surviving. At present, plant breeders are using very narrow genetic base of crop improvement. Added to that, germplasm movement is restricted. Adequate genetic variation is available for traits of economic importance. Pre-breeding with wild relatives will help to mine the genes. This is one area because this may be done in other crops like rice, but not in legumes. This I have skipped because these are the various techniques chronologically we have come up to nanotechnology. Research priorities, super early PGNP, early vigor, non-shattering mung beans, then plant type based plant breeding and varieties suitable for machine harvesting. These are the things which we need to reconstruct in grain legumes. Choice of breeding depends on target genotype. Target genotype means you have to define what is your recombinant, expected recombinant. And then when the expected recombinant is known, then you try to make your parental selection so that you can reduce number of crosses. Choice of breeding method help in creating such recombinants in high frequency. Pedigree method, backcross method, gene actions governing quantitative traits will all determine based on the trait we are going to transfer. A sound knowledge on plant breeding helps in identifying parents, effective choice of breeding methods, selection and fixing of recombinants, gaining confidence in handling material. Lack of proper knowledge in the above at times may lead to irrevocable loss of valuable material. This is where you all will agree with me. Once the material is in someone's bad person's handle, and you will lose the material, we cannot reconstruct them also. Make plant breeding an interesting subject. Discuss and exchange views regularly. This is what I started with Tikku when I was in IIHR. We used to have weekly, fortnightly exchange of some chapters. Improve skills in plant breeding. We work together, try to help each other in their breeding aspects. Understanding of the work behind the success stories of successful plant breeders will give us boost. However, in the present day plant breeding, emphasis is laid on the array of related subjects which are supposed to form new tools of plant breeding, but less time is spent on understanding the genetic basis of defining finer steps of plant breeding. And this is where I once again reiterate all of you, and we are all good at conventional plant breeding. There is nothing to replace conventional plant breeding. We add anything over that. Quantitative genetics, I don't think I have to tell everybody here, we are all breeders, but no two individuals are identically same. Discrete differences that bring hard cash to farmer are usually quantitative. So breeding methods based on gene actions, governing a trait, to break the close linkage of closely associated quantitative traits is important. Now coming to hybrid technology, this is where I am not questioning the technology. I like the technology, I would like to have hybrids also. But what I want to say is, the present century is being used as era of hybrids. Unless you say it is a hybrid, there won't be market. But hybrid also ultimately can be defined on plant type basis. So the mechanism of autrosis itself is not fully understood, but it has been exploited fully. So hybrid culture of agriculture is the order of the day. Continue with hybrids, continue produce hybrids, but hybrids also, the parents also should be based on the plant type traits. Smart breeding, of course, is an added tool, biotechnological tool, marker assisted selections, etc., etc., will be new tools to plant breeding. And in combination with conventional plant breeding, molecular aid selection may deliver results quickly. Thank you.
Okay.
See, this is a plant type which got an award in an exhibition. That's why it was given a flower there.
Oh, that's a nice one.
Very like a bouquet. Yeah. This type of plant supported up to 250 pods per plant. So we can achieve higher yields in legumes, working closely on plant type aspects. Now my topic I'm over, and it is open for discussion now. Now can I put the
thank you, Satyan. Yeah, you can take it off, and I think there is a scope for how much time we have. We can spend about 15-20 minutes. Everybody yes, okay with that? Because I feel there are a couple of points that would be nice to hear some, you know, discussion. It will be very interesting. And then I will try to sum up what Dr. Satyan says.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
First, let us listen to questions.
I want to actually just have a comment from Satyanarayana, good old friend. Just now he mentioned that conventional breeding, there is no replacement for that. But Satyanarayana, nowadays we hear a lot about speed breeding, fast forward breeding, commercial breeding. So as a conventional old time breeder, what are your observations on these new words?
Yeah, I would like to hear them.
See, Dr. Tikku said, defect elimination gave us a lot of improvement in yields. Yes, defect elimination goes on. Defect elimination must go also. Not only the cryogenes have come in. And I fully agree with him. Whether it is stress, yes, when the stress is removed, yield comes. When the disease is removed, yield comes. So that is defect elimination. But original plant yield quotation per se has to be improved. Now, when you come about talk about conventional breeding, the speed breeding is nothing but speeding up your conventional breeding.
Yes.
How the generation is advanced fast, how the information can be overcome, and what type of measures you can take. Ultimately, the breeding is conventional breeding only, not molecular breeding. So, whatever you call even gene editing coming up nowadays, even the gene editing is nothing but a defect elimination. So, but where we can make two pods in place of one pod, that is the plant type. That is what I want to stress. Even be it a hybrid, be it a variety, be it a defect elimination breeding. But in a defect elimination, the plant is giving its potential. Suppose its potential is 100. Can we make it 150? Can we make it 200? That is something else subject.
Yeah, actually, to that I'll add Satyan and Dr. Khadakwalji. You are right. I mean, those are, in my opinion, they are adjuncts to conventional breeding. They only help us speed up. They only make us more efficient, because you can molecular aided breeding, you can transfer a trait to your mutation breeding with gene editing becomes more precise. But they are basics. The basic thing is genetics and conventional.
They are additional tools.
They are additional tools. They help us become more efficient and more faster. I hope you agree with that.
Here you see Dr. Tikku, Dr. Ghatak, Dr. Khargawal, Dr. Vanjari, and myself. We all none have hair on the top. Yeah. None of us are having hair here. That is an indication we have put most of our efforts on the crop improvement.
Chairman, I would like to.
Vanjari.
Yeah, please.
Dr. Satyanarayan has given a very good information to improve the pulses production and pulses productivity. He considered many aspects. Now, there is a big debate, big debate going on through Times of India on the GM technology. And example is always given for BT. I think in pulses also BT transgenics are available with chickpea as well as pigeon pea. So I would like to hear the opinion of Dr. Satyanarayana about what will be the future of BT in these food crops, particularly legumes.
It's a big question, because everybody is breaking their heads on that only, because whether to give permission for food crops or not. BT technology, no doubt, has created a lot of revolution in cotton. And as a result of that, the heliotis has become low on chickpea also, because the multiplication cycle stopped. Now, the question is, new problems are coming up on the BT cottons. Now, pink bollworm, they are unable to manage. So new problems do come. So if one defect is eliminated, plant breeding is nothing but aiming at a moving target. By the time you solve one problem, new problem will come. So this is already there. But question is, BT technology can come to food or not? But my opinion, if BT technology was not introduced in India, by now we would have made a beautiful IPM, which people have not carried out. BT cotton has come.
I would like to add here, although the BT cotton is taken as the example of success for transgenic, I will say that during last 20 years, we are stuck up with certain problems, and particularly when the new versions of BT came into the existence, the proposers are not in favor of biotesting them continuously, and I feel that our testing program must be there. As we test for, evaluate for yield, same thing should be there to evaluate every event of BT for its biosafety also. In case of pigeon pea or chickpea, these are food crops, and at present there is a moratorium on the even testing on farmer's field of this material. And although this molecular breeding and mass-assisted selection has helped us to a certain extent, we should go in big way to assemble the QTLs in the productive variety so that we can increase more. That way, that is an important thing. One, I want to give one comment about the breeding for earliness. This agenda is being kept for last 60-70 years. Right from Dr. Paroda or Dr. Ramanujam, that time they have initiated and they have developed a good material also. I think first early pigeon pea was Prabhat, bred by Dr. Shankarlal. But it was with small seed type. Subsequently, seed size was improved in early genotypes. But what I found that earliness is not very determinate type. And the determinate genotypes, which are just like ICPL 87 or Pragati, whenever they are grown on large area, they succumb to the humid climate of August, September, during which the flowering coincide. And actually, this is the actual target for the technology like BT to help the farmers to avoid the incidence of Helicorpa there.
Yes.
And this BT Definitely, as we have seen in case of wheat, to eliminate rust, we had to had continuous efforts and pyramiding these resistant genes. Here on BT, we cannot rely for many days. And the breaking the resistance of against the particular BT is very common or will be very common because Helicorpa is a polyphagous pest. And therefore, there should be some strategies of IPM. I fully agree with Dr. Satyanarayana that due to this BT, the IPM has been neglected. And now, while bringing VG3 cotton in the cultivation, people are asking for the convenience for weed control, and therefore they are putting herbicide tolerance, which are having its own problem. Own problem means the cancer is on rise for so many years. And in Nagpur, there was no facility for radiation of the cancer treatment. Now there are 7 big hospitals where the expenses of 2 to 3 lakhs rupees per day are going on by these cancer patients. And when we pass on through the endemic COVID-19, we must learn lesson how to keep our health in order. And we will have to see all these biotechnological tools, particularly transgenics, for their bad effects wherever they are. I am not against any biotechnology or GM crops, but there must be a good, sufficient knowledge about its side effects also.
Thank you very much. I think you have made my statement very easy. Now the question is, breeding for early varieties, late varieties, medium varieties is different, but I am emphasizing on early vigor. Early vigor, because if initially vigor is not there, it won't put up a canopy. Now, early varieties, what you talk about ICPL 87 or Pragati and what is that?
Prabhat.
They are of 130 days, but I am talking about variety of 100 days and these two as a post rainy season crop so that it can go in rotation. Anyway, now there are so many illegal testing of okra BTs, brinjal BTs, everything going on unofficially everywhere. That has no control in this country.
That is the problem.
So it is easy. Actually, as Vanjar has said, BT is one of the component of IPM. So why must concentrate all research organizations and NGOs on workable IPM strategies?
But Tikku, I want to make a quick comment on Dr. Satyanarayana's mention of IPM. I think he said it. BT can be one important component of IPM. Yeah.
Exactly.
He also said another thing, that all the three are having no hair on their head. I was visiting Dr. Patak in Taiwan, AVRDC, and in his room, his daughter had put a very nice poster. I remember that. It says, God made only few perfect heads, rest he covered with hair. So I think that's, you should be happy that you don't have your perfect heads.
Sorry for that comment.
Okay, I'm sorry.
All these four are my colleagues. So I made that comment.
Sorry, Satyan, just a minute. I think I heard, Aparna, would you just 5-10 minutes more? Is it okay?
Yes, sir,
everybody is okay with that? Okay. I heard one, this Rajiv, I had thought that he would come in and say something about hybrid because his talk is going to be on hybrid. And the second is, I think Dr. Redeya or somebody had raised their hand. Is somebody wanting to say something? Is there anybody?
Yeah, can I? Yes, I will have one comment.
Yeah, please.
Satyanarayana, I think it was a very nice presentation, and I can say, as usual, you are one of my favorite breeder. Wonderful breeder. I respect you for that, and rather I have learned many things from you for the breeding. Now, only thing I'm asking you about, pulses we consider very highly nutritious in the vegetarian diet. Are we also working in something on nutritional aspects, particularly like they say uric acid or something which can be increased if you eat a lot of legumes? So are we having some kind of work on those nutritional factors also in legumes? Yeah.
Yeah, many people are working, yeah, particularly on the protein profile, amino acid profile. Mm-hmm. There are, because to add quality to the food, well, the work is going on.
It's very important for Indian diets, because yeah, pulses is one of the major components.
You cannot live without dal.
Yes.
Yeah. I think now Rajiv has raised a hand. So
yes.
Rajiv, you're welcome. Yeah.
Sir, thank you very much. Paul. I think this is a really inspiring movement, you know, to be listening to such people, such seniors, you know, senior crop breeders who have invested a whole lifetime and who definitely belong to the cream of India. And you know, for you know, I mean, I'm not exactly young now, but I mean, listening to people who have invested, you know, so I mean, it's all the more inspiring. But also, you know, in this particular case, I have a remark to make. Dr. Alapathy has, you know, see, I mean, the next topic we are going to discuss the next time is about hybrid vigor. And I mean, what I have seen is normally people, many of the people, they have black and white pictures about hybrid vigor, the basis of hybrid vigor, and whether or not heterosis exists. And I could see something very similar in Dr. Alapathy, and he's made a very clear statement that even by using, you know, simply without, you know, simply by basing our reasoning on dominance, we can have inbred lines which are as good as hybrids. So I think the conflict still exists, and this is something which really needs to be addressed. Now, I mean, I, you know, trying to pinpoint it down to another term, well, putting it in other words, is does over-dominance exist at all? And secondly, how far the dominance, over-dominance is expressed in different crops? Is it a crop-by-crop variance? And secondly, looking at the molecular basis, can we prove over-dominance based on molecular tools and molecular evidence? So these are the points I would like to take up in my talk, once I'm being given very kindly the chance by ADPDR to present this talk. And I think these are the things we will be discussing. And I have some of, so not revealing too much, but definitely, does over-dominance exist at all? And secondly, how far does it vary from crop to crop? And where is the molecular evidence? These points I'll be taking up specifically in the coming talk, sir.
Yeah, I would also to hear your lecture on the hybrid vigor.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
But what I just want to add to that is, people have to breed for the parental line development.
Sir.
Yeah, parental line development. And that also by creating heterotic populations. Yeah, naturally, exactly. The crop like rice and other crops, self-pollinated crops. Mm-hmm. But whether it is over dominance or dominance is immaterial. I think dominance is working, and over dominance means if there is nearly a plant type trait in that. But that is resulting into physical yield more than the more best, better parent. So over dominance, dominance, or anything, I told in one sentence, the genetic basis of heterosis is not fully understood. But still, it is 100% exploited. So we have to live with it. It is an era we are living in, like Mohenjo-daro time. Now it is hybrid time. So we have to live with hybrids, and we have to improve further. You develop your parental lines. But what is going on in India is everybody is stealing others' parents.
Satyan, you just hit the nail on the head. Problem is, the parental, I'll just give an example of maize. If everybody understands that today's maize inbreds have the same yields as the double crosses and triple crosses.
Correct.
Yes.
Because there has been constant inbred improvement. So your heterosis percentage may have remained the same, but the yield has increased because your inbreds have improved. The heterosis, even if it is the same 20% or 50%, your yield has increased. So we have to do the same thing. Wherever heterosis
is existing, which means hybrid vigor, then you have to continuously improve the parents. Without that, you will not continue to get the total yields. That I agree. But we will do this more discussion on hybrid heterosis when next month.
No, I will also participate in that lecture.
Please, it will be good. So, is there any other last minute question?
I have one question or curiosity, I would say. Well, thank you, Alapati sir, for a great presentation. It was a nice learning for all of us. My query is that pulses is a very important component of our diet. As you mentioned, that most of the people, especially vegetarian, that is the only source of protein for us, the major source of protein. So why we didn't have that attention like wheat and rice? Still, you see that pulse is very expensive component in your plate. So is that we don't have the high yielding variety, or the research attention is still lacking in that domain?
The moment you have irrigation water, fertilizers, pesticides, the responsive crop like rice and wheat have taken that, and they have taken the share of all the land. So pulses are further relegated to marginal lands because they think that they still can give you yield. But still, they are still maintaining the yield production level in the country, even with relegation to marginal lands, is only because of the improvement in varieties we have made. So they have to be given that due share in the input allotment, irrigated share, fertilizer share, like that. Then certainly pulses will come up.
Okay.
I think their capacity to fix nitrogen has become a curse for them.
I have a point here. When we say that there is a supply demand situation, when I know the pulses from the beginning, I have known they are very expensive compared to other grains and other things. But why still we still don't consider pulses as so important at the farmers level? I personally feel that most of our business component, I say, at present in India or maybe in other countries, depending on the private industries. And no private industry is interested in pulses because there is no hybrid vigor. As soon as a company releases a variety, next day there are 10 people taking it. Next day.
That is the problem.
Maybe one of the reasons.
Not because of the hybrid vigor. So, the problem is that you invest crores of rupees on your R&D and you come up with a good variety, next day you lose control on that. That is the problem.
Exactly.
The problem is that nobody is confident to invest, after all, in private sector.
We spend
close to 4 crores per year on one crop.
It is easily pirated, but only thing is, these particular pulses, why farmer is not getting encouraged? Because he is getting more yield of other crops, more profit from other crops. Yeah. But you make it competitive, then they will come.
But I think I have one answer to that. What I have seen, and this is what I used to tell even in Pioneer and Syngenta, that I think this fear we have to worry. We have to take it that 20% of your material will go, and they will go and sell it and do some fly-by-night operation. But we must not forget that a company that develops a new OP variety and produces good quality and good quantity of seed in time and supplies to the farmer comes back. You see, a company like Advanta sells GSNP. From 100 tons, they are selling nearly 1,000 tons today. If everybody would be able to produce, then why would they grow? So I have seen OPs from good companies. If a new variety has come, there is growth 10 to 20% even for the first 5-7 years, if they maintain good quality and quantity.
That credibility carries.
We have to go over. But yes, this fear is why people are not.
I will intervene, Tikku. I will say, how many private companies are investing in legume breeding? Zero.
That is correct.
Nobody
anyway, we are doing it.
They should.
Doctor,
based on that. Anyway, this is a very, very
Dr. Pathak.
Yeah.
The
yeah.
moment you see me and Tiku, let me sum up. You get more questions.
We stop it here.
We stop it here.
I'll just try and sum up. Thank you, Dr. Satyanarayana. Thank you very much. I think pulses, as you said very rightly, the first slide was that it's a neglected crop, and we know it is a neglected crop for so many reasons, because maize, wheat, rice, and sorghum, sunflower, they took away most of the work, because there was profit at the end, and there was minimum support price from the government, especially in the north, so the farmers had better returns on their money. So I think
the fact that I don't agree with India
made 2016 as the year of pulses, things will start getting more, and as the fact that with pandemic people are now this immunity, this protein and all, vegetarian country, so I think pulses will increase, in my opinion. Pulses will get more attention. You can see in the next gate, we might see more of pulse work rather than only the cereals. You will see that. And I think I like the idea that you mentioned clearly that, soybean has so much yield. Why? Because the plant type can bear that kind of yield. The harvest index is more. So we need to work on improving the genetics of this. Very rightly you said that we are actually reusing the same genetics. We keep crossing between the same varieties that are released, they cross with each other. No new genes are getting funneled into that. So we need to go crop-wide relatives of each crop and bring in the new genes. Then only your basic plant type will increase and your yield will increase. So very, very correctly, we have to increase the yields of the parental lines so that we can get more yield. And so, you talked about earliness. Look at rice. Today, there is a rice, 104 days, and there is a very large area under that variety because it suits their crop rotation. There are hybrid rice, 104 days, 120 days, 140 days. Similarly, in maize, as rice is self-pollinated, maize, we have from 120 days to 160 days, depending on the location and the period. Rabi maize in Bihar is 160 days. Now they are also looking at 140 days. So earliness is possible, but again, not without breeding the right parents.
Earliness is not for everywhere, but for a particular niche, for a particular area.
It has to be case by case.
I have a guest with me. We have to move from here.
Okay.
What I request all of you is, whenever possible, you visit Guntur.
We will. Anybody can. I will be visiting, of course, in November.
You can see my
material,
crops, plant types, everything in the
paper. Your sum up was narrow germplasm base of pulses needs to be improved so that we can get the ultimate new varieties with better yield, your idiotype breeding, and poor emphasis on real plant breeding, because as you said, between the same, here is a good variety, here is a good variety, you cannot keep on giving you better varieties. You need to get new genes. Dr. Vanjari rightly said the QTLs that are contributing to yield need to be put together.
One answer to Dr. Pathak is that Arka Komal was released in 82-83.
Yeah.
And it is still leading. So even if it is a OP variety, if it is good from a particular organization, Ashoka seed is selling most of it. But IHR also gets a maximum seed indent.
Yeah, they get builder seed indent continuously.
So there is not that OP varieties, there is no business. There is business. Most
it
of the varieties are OPs only.
You will see that it will happen in the next decade. There will be a lot of pulse breeding.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, everybody. I think thanks again, Dr. Satyan, for invigorating, getting us into this discussion, which is important. Part of the whole story. Thank you, Dr. Vanjari, for your input, Dr. Karakwal, Dr. Pathak, and others who have come in. And thank you, Rajiv, and we will look forward to your, because that's a good, I think, next one after this discussion, that will be interesting topic, because you are going into the modern technology and what it will do to heterosis breeding. So look forward to that.
Thank you.
Thank you once again.